Welcome, everyone. So happy that you're able to join us. This would be our eighth lecture in our series of Engaging Racism. And this series, as many of you know, is funded by the FSU Askew School of Public Administration, specifically the Social Justice and Innovation Lab. Of course, hosted by the Tallahassee Chan Center. My name is Gua Gu. Some of you know me as Dr. Jimmy Yu. I teach at FSU in the religion department. Also at the Tallahassee Chan Center, I'm the teacher. Tonight, we are very happy to get Dr. Robert Eschmann. And we've been trying to invite him for a while. Last semester, he was on sabbatical leave, so we weren't able to actually have him. But we're happy that he's able to present his work with us tonight. So Dr. Eschmann is an assistant professor at the Boston University. He is an assistant professor in the Boston University School of Social Work, also an affiliate faculty member in the Department of Sociology and African American Studies Program. He's also the assistant director of research at the Boston University Center for Anti-Racism Research. And his work is so relevant to our current digital age, bringing together, kind of bridging the gap between online communication and kind of real life, real world racism on the ground. He researched on educational inequality, community violence, racism, and social media and youth well-being. And his forthcoming book, Bridging the Gap Between Virtual and Face-to-Face Experience, focusing on racism in the education system, specifically online communication. And his forthcoming book with University of California Press, very prestigious press, When the Hood Comes Off, Racism and Resistance in the Digital Era. And this book systematically explores the ways online communication has changed the expressions of racism and its effect on community of color and society and resistance to racism at individual and structural levels. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Eschmann. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this important series. So I've seen some of the other folks who have come. I've watched some of the talks, and I know that you all are having great conversations. So I'm very glad for you to be having these conversations, especially in light of the extended, sustained protests against anti-Black police violence that we've seen over the past year. So it's quite a time to be, an important time to be thinking about and studying racism. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. Let me get my slides up. Looks like that didn't work. Okay. The title of my presentation today is Making a Microaggression, Technology and Resistance Against Racism. My research question here is, How does the internet affect the way students of color experience, interpret, and respond to racial microaggressions, right? So first, let me start with a definition, right? What are microaggressions? So during the Jim Crow era, the US racial system was typified by overt expressions of racism and openly discriminatory policies and institutions. So in contrast, the post-civil rights movement era is characterized by an avoidance of or subtle usage of race in interpersonal and political discourse and covert social mechanisms that reproduce inequality. So while this shift from overt to covert may decrease the visibility of racism, the primary function of racism, which is to maintain the racial status quo or racial inequality, remains the same. One of the ways that racial inequalities are reproduced in contexts that frown on overt racism is through microaggressions, which is defined as being intentional or unintentional negative racial slights. Microaggressions can reinforce the marginal status of people of color by questioning their intelligence, criminality, or appearance. And experiences with microaggressions are often interpreted as being related to race by the victim or the targets, but are often ignored or seen as being not related to race by the perpetrator or by bystanders. We know that experiences with microaggressions have negative effects on wellness and productivity, including health, mental health, and performance at work and in school. And on college campuses in particular, students of color who experience microaggressions are more likely to engage in binge drinking, have higher levels of anxiety, higher levels of depression, lower self-esteem, and may be less likely to seek help if they believe that doing so would reinforce negative stereotypes. So despite, you know, the negative effects of experiencing racial microaggressions, there's consensus in the research that the most common response to microaggressions is to do nothing. And there are a number of reasons why folks tend to do nothing when they experience microaggressions, right? So the top six reasons listed by Sue in his book, 2010 book, are not being sure that a microaggression has occurred, not knowing how to respond, not being able to respond quickly enough, the tendency for targets of microaggressions to make themselves think the microaggression did not actually occur, the belief that responding to racial microaggressions is futile and won't change anything, and perhaps most importantly, fear of potential negative consequences of responding to racial microaggressions due to racial power dynamics in various social contexts. That, you know, despite these things hurting, people don't want to lose friends explaining to their coworkers, their friends, why, you know, the microaggression hurt them when, you know, their colleagues may not see it as being that big of a deal. So given the difficulty of responding to microaggressions in mainstream spaces, people of color may look to process these experiences in counter spaces, defined as social spaces where people of color seek to not only avoid hostile racial interactions, but also actively participate in celebrating and affirming their racial or ethnic identities. On college campuses, counter spaces can include clubs, study halls, or even informal peer groups, and are often formed in response to student experiences with microaggressions on campus. Within counter spaces, students can engage in identity work that challenges dominant narratives, cultural expressions as acts of resistance, or acts of relational or social support. Largely populated by people of color, the norms about talking about race or racial microaggressions in counter spaces may differ from those in mainstream spaces. There's a long history of counter spaces serving as catalysts for student organizing on college campuses. For example, here we see an example in Berkeley, California, where of a student protest where students blocked off entry to campus spaces as a way of demanding more safe spaces for students of color on campus. So we have examples of students in response to microaggression seeking institutional support for the creation of counter spaces, such as this Berkeley protest, or, you know, other protests across the country demanding new dorms or funding for student groups. But the focus of most research on microaggressions is less on how students of color combat the microaggressions themselves, and instead on the negative impact of those microaggressions on people of color and how they cope. So while the latter is theoretically and practically interesting, I believe it can reduce students of color to victims who are being acted on and who only resist the actions of their oppressors behind closed doors. I'm much more interested in exploring the ways that students of color resist the ideologies that promote microaggressions and refuse to accept the prevalence of microaggressions as normal, acceptable, or immutable. So in this presentation, I explore the ways that students of color actively respond to microaggressions in online spaces. I suggest that the internet structures a distinct type of racial discourse and gives students of color access to unique tools and opportunity structures for countering racial microaggressions. So there's a growing body of literature around the ways that Black people and people of color are using technology to resist racism that, you know, that I'm grateful to be able to draw on. So Brock's 2008 analysis of Black blogs following Hurricane Katrina found that while mainstream media ignored the perspective of poor struggling Blacks, the internet served as a scaffolding to support these Black writers and journalists in the creation and dissemination of a counter narrative that questioned the actions and motivations of the government in regards to racial inequality and prejudice in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. And then, of course, two of the top three hashtags used on Twitter in the past decade are hashtag Ferguson and hashtag Black Lives Matter, both of which are used to communicate around activist activities in response to the shooting of Black people, often unarmed by police officers. The research, right? So through these hashtags, activists are able to bypass traditional media gatekeepers, and in some cases have become bigger hubs for information sharing on organizing activities than mainstream journalists are. Ray and colleagues talk about the use of hashtags to generate solidarity around social issues, something they conceive of as a social identity. And Brown and colleagues discuss the intersectional nature of these conversations as activists and engaged folks think about anti-Black racism in conjunction with the ways that race intersects with other marginalized identities, including gender, sexual identity, gender identity, class, religion, et cetera. Other research looks at participatory politics, which is defined as online political activity that is interactive, peer-based, and not subordinated under a formal institution and addresses public issues. Examples of participatory politics include the swift internet blackout response against the Stop Online Piracy Act, which halted Congress's support of the bill, and the change.org petition, which successfully prevented an expensive change in Bank of America's debit card policies. So research on youth and politics has found that up to 45% of youth surveyed received news from Facebook or Twitter at least once per week. And these numbers are higher among Black and Latinx youth. And right, while some people have called participatory politics, a weak form of activism, research finds that youth who engage in participatory politics are more likely to engage in traditional modes of civic engagement when they become adults. There's also been research done on Black Twitter, which is defined as an online gathering of Twitter users who identify as Black and employ Twitter features to perform Black discourses and build social affinities. This is one of the ways that some of these forms of activism gain visibility on social media in mainstream spaces, that a lot of social media activism, right, through Black Twitter becomes hyper-visible through social media activism and Black culture. One example of this are memes around Karen and Barbecue Becky, which depict white people calling the police on Black people for what is perceived to be no reason. These memes are a form of social commentary on problematic white behaviors that have gone viral over the past few years. A lot of this research looks at the connection between technology and resistance on a large scale. And so thinking about these big movements that make the news, and what I'm focusing on today, right, is informed by these literatures, but is a little bit different because this is not something that's happening, right, in conjunction necessarily with broader movements, but I'm more looking at how people of color use technology to respond to racial microaggressions that happen in the moment, right? There are no cameras watching. This is not part of a march. This is part of people's everyday lives. So how are people using technology to engage in acts of resistance in everyday situations where they may not have a large audience? So my methods for this study, I conducted in-depth interviews with 38 undergraduate students of color at a university, a private selective university in the Midwest that I call MidU. Of those 38 participants, 23 were women, 15 were men, 5 identified as Latinx, 3 identified as Afro-Latinx or mixed with Black and Latinx, 19 identified as Black or African American. 5 identified as multiracial or mixed with Black and white. 5 identified as Asian, and 1 identified as Indian. Mid-U is a largely liberal campus, and this ethos in some ways shapes the way that race is talked about. I advertised the study using posters at key locations, and I also recruited a purposive sample from student cultural organizations. So I wanted to find students who were actively engaged in finding ways and spaces to talk about race and racism. I used an open-ended survey instrument influenced by a framework for understanding institutional climate and the online victimization scale. Participants were asked questions regarding their experiences on campus at MidU, the perceptions of the meaning of race on campus, and their experiences with racialized interactions online. I used Small's sequential interviewing strategy so that what was learned with each case or participant influenced the rest of the interviews as I added questions or got rid of questions to reflect what had already been learned. I engaged in thematic coding in vivo, which is a qualitative data analysis program. And I use in vivo primarily because of its integration with social media. You know, there's a way to download hundreds of tweets in a data set with the click of a button. And then I use an abductive grounded theory approach to analyzing the data. So in line with the grounded theoretical approach, I wrote memos throughout the analytical process in order to simultaneously interact with data and theory. But I also use an abductive approach to grounded theory, which is a bit different than a traditional grounded theory approach, where researchers attempt to go into the field without preconceived ideas about what's happening based on theory, the goal being to let theory emerge naturally from the data. Instead, I was cognizant of when findings were surprising or I went into the field with background knowledge in theory, but throughout the analysis, I was cognizant of when findings were surprising or outside of the scope of the project's original theoretical framing. So I approached the data with a theoretically informed analysis, but also looked to build new theory for understanding how the internet shapes the expression of racist ideologies in online spaces and how students of color react to these distinct expressions. So there are two, you know, theoretical constructs that come out of this investigation. So I find that students of color engage in the production of what I term online counter spaces, which are defined as online social spaces that structure critical racial discussions as students of color challenge the reproduction of dominant paradigms for understanding race, highlight and critically react to vicarious or direct experiences with microaggressions, and provide support for other students of color in the midst of what are perceived to be hostile racialized interactions. So online counter spaces are distinct from traditional counter spaces as they require less institutional support to function, are often racially integrated, structure a unique presentation of racial discussion, and can be permanent online spaces, but often are temporary spaces created in real time around specific racialized incidents or interactions. And second, online racial checking, which is defined as critical responses to microaggressions or racist ideologies in online spaces. So Bonilla Silva suggests that speech about race-related issues will be scarce in contexts that are characterized by the dominant colorblind racial ideology, places where people don't pretend or say that they can't see race. So this idea is consistent with the way students of color describe conversations about race on campus as being rare and largely avoided by white students. But students also make a distinction between face-to-face racial discussions on campus and online racial discussions, the latter occurring with much more frequency. For example, Tasha, a Black woman, says, "Compared to more face-to-face interaction, I think they talk about it more online, because I think obviously, you know, sort of being behind a computer is much more easier to sort of articulate your thoughts. You can sort of form an opinion and sort of lay down your argument much more easily than if you're like in the heat of debate or anything like that." So here we see that some basic characteristics of online communication, such as the ability to interact with others without being in their physical presence and on your own time, not theirs, may increase the comfort level that many students have talking about race. More comfort means more conversations. And Tasha continues to share how many of the online racial discussions start. "The friends I associate with, they're very like activist-y, you know? So they're always sharing articles like, what do you guys think? And also here, there's a lot of academic debates. If there's anything going on in the world, they really want to talk about it and see other people's point of view." The students interested in generating discussions about race on campus are often frustrated by the lack of outlets. One reason counter spaces exist, in fact, is because issues of racial identity and justice are not perceived to be welcome in mainstream campus spaces. On the internet, however, activist-y students, or students who are racially conscious or engaged, have more agency in shaping and advertising racial discussions. They need not wait until the monthly Black Student Union meeting to talk about the latest Ta-Nehisi Coates piece. Instead, by simply sharing a link, they can start this discussion immediately, and they may be interacting with a larger group online than they typically would in person. Rachel, a Black woman, talks more about this difference. If you would take the same conversations or the same ideas that you discuss online and try to put them in the school cafeteria or the library, it definitely wouldn't be as welcoming of an environment. People seem unwilling to listen, and people usually in person like to deny that there is a race issue from what I've experienced. So not talking about race reinforces white colorblind norms and maintains campus social spaces as being dominated by white culture and norms. In contrast, when activist students share race-related material and start racial discussions, they are creating online counter spaces. Finding these spaces is important for all of the reasons that in-person counter spaces are important. They affirm racial or ethnic identities and facilitate critical thinking about dominant racial structures. But unlike on-campus counter spaces, which are typically populated by students of color, online counter spaces are racially integrated. The ability to craft mainstream spaces of resistance visible to both students of color and white students gives students of color increased agency in molding the racial climate of their institution. Rebecca, an Afro-Latinx student, continues to discuss other characteristics unique to online spaces that facilitate the construction of online counter spaces. They have access to more resources to like back themselves up quickly. So you can just pull up a link, like direct someone towards information, being able to say, this is what I'm talking about. You can't deny this. This is proof of it. So I think there's that confidence in that you're online. It can be hard to talk about race, not only because race is an emotionally charged topic, but also people have different paradigms for understanding race and tend to talk past one another. For example, the dominant mode of thinking about race in ahistorical and individual terms limits the extent to which some whites can understand the complexities of racial interactions, let alone racial injustice. Having immediate access to sources and data, in this example, gives students of color the confidence and tools to poke holes in dominant paradigms for understanding race. Rachel shares how increased access to empirical resources and time to craft careful statements impacts the norms around online racial discourse. I didn't really care about grammar, but if you're on Facebook and you're talking to a mid-U person, you should make sure that you have like a nice thesis, an intro, some citations. It encourages you to sit and kind of meditate on what other people say before you respond and type out a very thoughtful response and make sure you have evidence to back it up. I suggest that it may take this increased effort, soundness of argument, and relevant evidence to counter commonly held folk beliefs about race. The normalization of formal language, evidence, and peer critique can help establish online counter spaces as uniquely capable of facilitating resistance to dominant norms around racial discussions, including silence and color blindness. Individual level and ahistorical explanations for racial inequality, for example, may be less convincing in contexts where respondents can quickly share information about the structural or historical antecedents to various forms of inequality. On campus, counter spaces are meant to be safe spaces for students of color, places where they can experience a respite from microaggressions. In contrast, online counter spaces are not safe spaces. Hank, a Black man, talks about how online norms structure racial messaging online. There's a certain degree of like liberation where you can say what you feel, right? And like people can scrutinize you, but they're not scrutinizing you to your face. So it's not as like harmful. It's not as like conflicting, like if you were to say something like potentially controversial and people like call you out on it, like in class or something, and then you are forced to defend yourself, but like in person. So I feel like online, people are probably more likely to say like certain things, to give more like controversial opinions because they have like time to defend it and like look up statistics and like they are not actually face to face with the person. The same characteristics of online communication that make racial dialogues easier to hold then also make it easier to share fringe or offensive ideas. David, a Black and Latinx man, has had similar experiences. It's a very interesting way to see how people actually feel about racial issues. In many ways, it's actually kind of refreshing because people can have like really honest debates that for some reason they feel like they can't have in person. It also doesn't mean that everything that people say is intelligent. It actually means that people have no filter. Whereas, you know, you might be a little more careful, right? Or a little bit more nuanced in front of a person. For David, the prevalence of racist attitudes online is indicative of how whites really think about race. And this impacts the way he thinks about his superficial interactions with some whites on campus. Angela, a Black woman, also believes that people are more blunt and honest on social media, even when they are not anonymous. She has this to say about reading these online posts that might be considered racially offensive. In the context of the university, I misread that last quote. So this is Angela's quote here. So here, this conflict between Angela's view that folks are more careful about talking about race in person and Rachel's view that folks are more careful about how they talk about race online. Indeed, Rachel's characterization of online racial discourse as being more articulate and intentional than in-person discourse is counterintuitive, given what we know about how online discourse tends to be more violent. But Angela and Rachel are using the term careful in different ways. For Angela, careful on-campus interactions refers to the politically correct style with which whites on campus approach racial discourse, ensuring that they do not say anything offensive. Rachel, on the other hand, is referring to the way students construct logical and evidence-based arguments about race in online spaces. So I suggest that online racial discourse is characterized by both increased controversial content, as students have no filter online, according to Angela, but also increased critical content, as students have the time and resources to craft meaningful responses to controversial posts, dominant racial views, or microaggressions. For those students who would engage in careful silence while on campus, online discourse provides freedom from the need to be kind and careful about race. For those students of color who wish to engage in careful but rigorous discussions, online discourse provides freedom from the need to avoid making whites feel uncomfortable when talking about racism on campus. Far from being a contradiction, this dynamic is at the core of what makes online counter spaces so unique. While Angela perceives a distinction between online and in-person racial discourse, here she does not express an understanding of where this difference comes from. Only that whites for some reason do not feel they can be honest in the way they talk about race in person. This assessment is consistent with the literature on how race is talked about or not talked about in some educational settings. Pollock uses the term color mute to refer to the way some whites see race and are therefore not colorblind, but choose not to speak about or acknowledge it. Students of color can be frustrated by color muteness or silence around race, but may not acknowledge or realize the way these norms can be protective for them. On one hand, not talking about race can shield whites who use silence to avoid being labeled a racist for saying the wrong thing. But on the other hand, color mute norms can limit more harsh expressions of racist ideologies. So here, Angela suggests that when whites are preoccupied with not saying anything offensive, their interactions, though less offensive, can come across as being disingenuous. Even when online racial discourse becomes offensive, she at least feels that she is not being lied to. In online counter spaces, students of color are more at risk of being exposed to overtly racist ideologies, but also have access to a unique set of tools that lets them identify and counter these ways of thinking about race. Furthermore, students of color have more support in online counter spaces. In person, microaggressions are only heard by people in the immediate vicinity, limiting the pool of people who can potentially respond and putting pressure on students of color to be a race representative. Not all students are equally equipped or inclined to respond. In online spaces, however, this pressure is reduced. Christina, an Indian American woman, explains, "In the context of the university community, when people make racial jokes, I think they are uninformed. And if you talk to them, if I talk to them and people speak up, you know, it's great. Because like our university is filled with people who will comment on a joke you make online and say like, hey, that's not okay. And this is why, which leads to a conversation. There are people who put forth academic arguments that are flawed, and it's very hard to argue against those kinds of people. But then again, there's like an entire legion of people who exist to argue against these people." Because online racial discussions do not require participants to occupy the same physical space, nor be engaged at the same time, there's a larger pool of potential respondents to microaggressions online than in person. While it is common for students of color to be the only student of color in their classrooms at predominantly white institutions, they are never the only person of color on the internet. Therefore, students of color are less pressured to respond to microaggressions or to be the voice for their race or ethnicity in online counterspaces. To further illustrate this point, Jelani spoke about a white student who made online comments disparaging the community surrounding the university and voicing how he felt unsafe with Black community members walking around or begging for money close to campus. The online response to these types of situations, according to Jelani, is consistent. There's never been a situation where no one has responded back to a comment like that. Someone always will step up, and it's not just like a Black person to a white person. It's like any race will comment and start saying what you're expressing is it's stupid and like it's offensive and like you really need to check yourself. So while the internet may increase risk of students of color being exposed to microaggression, it also increases immediate access to allies and support. Being a member of a group that is a numerical minority matters less in online spaces where small groups can have a large voice. The decreased power differential between whites and students of color in online counterspaces leads to whites facing increased peer accountability for making racial slights. Rachel speaks about the potential consequences of making offensive posts online. If someone says something really racist, you get a message like, "Did you see what she said? She's in my such and such class." And then they actually get side-eyed until you actually bring it up to them. That's a very, very easy way to be ostracized. You're not going to be able to still be accepted if you post something like racist or homophobic. This outcome, whites being made to feel uncomfortable on campus or being less accepted because of their views or comments on race, is different from what we have come to expect on college campuses. Students of color in online counterspaces have access to informal sanctioning mechanisms that not only punish perpetrators of racial slights, but also may discourage further racial slights. I use the term online racial checking to refer to critical responses to microaggressions or the expression of racist ideologies. So several students during the course of my interviews told me about an online incident where a white student took a picture of a Black man who was a dining hall employee sitting down and reading the school newspaper and posted it on a campus Facebook page and captioned with, "Ha ha." Miguel, a Black man who reported that he wrote 15 to 20 comments on the post, believed that the comment was laughing at a Black working class man reading, as if this were an oxymoron. But some online users did not accept this analysis. People were like, "Oh, no, you just don't get it. It's because someone is actually reading the school newspaper, guys. Like, you know, because no one reads the school newspaper." One guy was like, "Oh, you know, I definitely think that this dining hall employee can read. Maybe the fact that you took such offense to this only shows that you have insecurities about him not being able to read." And I was like, "Or maybe this is just racist." Now, one can imagine how this joke would be more defensible in person if the offending party was criticized for making a joke based on the stereotype that Black men can't read. They could easily respond by saying, "No, the joke was about the newspaper. I didn't even notice the guy reading it was Black." A person of color, whether or not they believe the explanation, might concede that it was a misunderstanding. To suggest otherwise could be interpreted as defamation of character, calling the person who made the comment a liar, or worse, a racist. And as indicated in the above quote, in this quote, "The only racist thing about the joke for some white students is the misguided suggestion that race was implied in the first place." Excuse me. Online, these types of colorblind arguments are less effective. People of color feel less alone and outnumbered in online counterspaces, so they are less likely to be intimidated into accepting that the incident was just a misunderstanding. Given this increased support around their understanding of the joke being about race, they experience less uncertainty about its racial implications and, using the tools unique to the online counterspace, are better able to articulate their arguments to support their interpretation. In this example, after about 100 comments, the original poster said he had made a mistake and deleted his original post. Now, while deleting the post does not necessarily signify a change of heart, it is indicative of a shift in power. For students of color, this event is not remembered as just another time that a white student got away with a hurtful microaggression or racist joke. Instead, students of color engaged in online racial checking by combating the microaggression, denying the legitimacy of a colorblind interpretation of the joke, and demonstrating that it was ultimately not welcome in the online counter space. Elsewhere in the interview, Angela spoke about how seriously she takes posts on social media and how she believes they are indicative of how people think when their guard is down. In this example, she suggests that the perceived appropriateness of the comment on the part of the original poster that we're talking about with the newspaper example was learned in other campus spaces. In the online counter space, however, claiming innocence does not absolve you of racial sins. Because the expression of racial stereotypes and microaggressions can go unchallenged in many on-campus spaces, this online racial checking incident may represent the first time the poster's racial ideology had been critiqued. Rachel talks about another example of racial checking that took place on the same campus website. This one girl posted like, overthought while walking behind a black guy. What if I robbed him just to be ironic? And someone was like, what? How is that ironic? Like, so you're admitting that you expect a black guy would rob you? Rachel noted that the consequences of this post extended to campus and said, for the next couple of weeks, when everybody saw that girl walking around on the quad, they're like, it's her. As previously discussed, implying the criminality of people of color is a textbook microaggression. And while colleges and universities are known for making statements against overtly racist incidents that cause headlines, racial slights like this, on the other hand, are more difficult to police, especially online. Even though we know online spaces are less moderated in general, this example suggests that online racial checking can function as a form of peer-based accountability that can carry over from online counter spaces to campus spaces. In this example, as the poster was being ostracized by many on campus, an activist of color approached her in person to talk about the incident. The poster acknowledged how she was wrong and showed interest in increasing her racial consciousness. Later that academic year, she came with the activist to a black student party where her interactions with students of color indicated to Rachel that she had changed the way she thought about race. Online racial checking not only increases the extent to which white students are made accountable for microaggression, but also may potentially be a part of an effective strategy for combating racist ideologies. Students who experience racial microaggressions in person, but are dissatisfied with their ability to react, can also turn to online racial checking as a means of responding to the racial event. Jeremiah relayed a story that began when he used the word "dough," slang for "though," in conversation on campus. A white student responded to him saying, "I didn't know we were talking about deer here, you know? And then I was just like, well, I wasn't talking about deer. I was very clearly using a form of slang, and that's how language works." When Jeremiah attempted to engage the student in conversation about the incident, the student simply walked away and was unwilling to participate. At this point in the interview, Jeremiah took out his laptop and read me the online post he made about the incident, which had garnered over 100 comments in a week's time. After hearing the post, I told him that it read like an essay, and he responded, "I like to write in a very provocative manner. So like I write it, I sit down, I have like a topic or I have like an article, you know, and I'll put my opinions about it and then I'll get to writing about it in a way I know people are going to come talk to me about it for. Certain people that either agree with me are going to say, I agree, but this is what I don't agree with. Or certain people are going to say, like, I don't agree with you at all. And that's where the conversation happens. These specific posts usually are written in a very long prose manner. The ones that garner the most attention are written in like an intricate manner." So Jeremiah was powerless to respond in person, as the person who made the comment was unwilling to talk about why Jeremiah thought it was problematic. In making a detailed, articulate, and critical online posting about the incident, however, Jeremiah started a discussion not only about this specific microaggression, but also the way students think about race and speech. Using social media, Jeremiah was able to engage in online racial checking and critique the microaggression, even though he did not have access to the microaggressor. Had he simply shared the incident in a traditional counter space, he would have had access to moral support from other students of color. But by engaging in online racial checking, Jeremiah created an online counter space where he not only had immediate access to personal support, but also increased his personal agency by using his experience to engage white students and students of color in a discussion that critiqued the prevalence of racial microaggressions on campus. In another example, Stephanie talks about how a student posted an article about Harriet Tubman being put on the $20 bill. a white man responded to this post indicating that he was going to miss Andrew Jackson. A flurry of comments ensued, with many students responded by pointing out how, among other morally questionable actions, Andrew Jackson had been involved in a genocide and therefore was not a historical figure that should be honored by his face on our currency. As the student continued to defend Andrew Jackson, Stephanie says this of her own response. I commented something like, oh my God, I can't even remember what this comment was, but it was gold. It was really good. A whole bunch of people liked it, and I felt validated by the fact that a whole bunch of people liked my like shaming of this guy. The idea that a white man can be shamed because he defends a white man who is an American historical figure, and that this shaming garners much support in the form of Facebook likes, is a shift in how we have traditionally thought about racial power dynamics on college campuses. By engaging in online racial checking, Stephanie participated in the creation of an online counter space where dominant historical narratives were questioned. She does not remember the words she used in her post, but she remembers the social impact it had, the support it received, and how, in that moment, the campus racial power dynamics were turned upside down. Online counter spaces are distinctive settings created by students of color online to talk about race and counter microaggressions. They differ from in-person counter spaces and sites of in-person racial discourse in several important ways. First, online counter spaces are structured by norms of discussion that privilege evidence, logic, and clarity of argument, characteristics that are often missing from in-person racial discourse and seem to run contrary to the hyper-aggressive style of discourse seen in other online contexts. The style of analysis found in counter spaces also tends to be intersectional, with discussions of race being enhanced by attention paid to other forms of oppression, including gender, sexuality, or religion. Second, the creation, maintenance, and content of online counter spaces is student or user driven and can take place in the absence of institutional support. Third, they are integrated spaces, not clubs, groups, or spaces accessible only to students of color. Along these lines, fourth, as online counter spaces are not limited by physical distance between parties, they include a larger audience than on campus counter spaces, giving students of color immediate access to increase support and amplifying their messages. Fifth, online counter spaces can be either temporary or permanent. While there's evidence of students of color creating specific online counter spaces dedicated to racial issues, like a permanent blog dedicated to Black beauty, for example, this presentation focuses more on transient social media-based online counter spaces formed in mainstream online social settings as students of color start racial discussions or respond to racial microaggressions. The potential for online counter spaces to take place outside of dedicated campus social locations takes racial discussions and critiques from the margins into the mainstream. Lastly, online counter spaces are characterized by online racial checking, which I use to describe the action of calling out and critiquing racial microaggressions or racist ideologies in online spaces. Students of color seem to be more comfortable with this form of critiquing racial microaggressions than they are with responding to racial microaggressions on campus. In part, this can be explained by the collaborative nature of online racial checking, which decreases the social pressure on any one student to respond and increases the support students of color perceive when critiquing racial microaggressions or dominant racial ideologies. It can be helpful to think about online counter spaces and online racial checking as being in a symbiotic relationship. The online counter space setting offers alternative norm structures around racial discourse and access to support mechanisms, features that enable online racial checking. At the same time, online racial checking sparks, supports, and sustains online counter spaces with explicit critiques of dominant racial ideologies and microaggressions. In tandem, online counter spaces and online racial checking structure a unique opportunity for students of color to demonstrate that they are not indefensible agents who are merely acted on by whites. These findings add more complexity to the discussion of racial microaggressions on college campuses and beyond. Prior research largely focuses on the negative impacts of microaggressions and students' internalized responses to these incidents. But here the focus is on externalized responses, including individual and group level processes and collaborative actions taken to combat racist ideologies. So I like to think about the internet as a growing, dynamic, and distinct ecological context that plays an increasingly large role in shaping the way that we interact. Young people live online, and if we're serious about wanting to help youth, we have to know this context. there are over 3.5 billion users on the internet. And about 90% of the youth in the Youth and Participatory Politics Survey have access to the internet. So my goal is to push researchers and educators and activists and social workers to better understand the changing social and intellectual landscapes that are occupied by today's youth. In 2017, Harvard rescinded offers of admission to 10 incoming freshman students because of their participation in a Facebook-based group chat that included the circulation of racist, sexist, and sexually offensive content. As many colleges and universities wrestle with this sometimes competing ideals of free speech on campus and the desire to protect students from harassment, this decision has the potential to influence the way that other institutions approach the regulation of offensive student speech in online spaces. Do schools have the right, the capacity, or the inclination to intervene when students engage in offensive behavior online? So the findings here suggest that as colleges and universities decide how to navigate the thin line between free speech and harassment, students of color may not rely on official policies to determine the way that they respond to racial microaggressions. In the absence of an institutional push against microaggressions, both in person and online, students of color in this sample independently assess, critique, and sanction racial microaggressions. I suggest to the extent that microaggressions function as mechanisms of the new racism, participating in online counter spaces and online racial checking is radical and subversive. For just as racial microaggressions are interpersonal acts that reinforce racist structures, online counter spaces and online racial checking are interpersonal acts that challenge white hegemony on campus and beyond. So how can this theory developed using data at one institution be better used to understand the dynamics of racial discourse in other online contexts? There are certain dynamics that create social incentives to engage in online racial checking in many online contexts. And I think that we can see evidence of the norms around racial discourse and the social acceptability of challenging microaggressions in other online spaces. So here we have a chart that shows the mentions of the term microaggression on Twitter between 2010 and 2018. This is a drastic growth of 6,603% in this 8-year period, and it's increased even more since 2018. So there are many potential explanations for why more people are talking about microaggressions online. Including increased attention to racial justice issues on Twitter through movements like the Black Lives Matter, and then also more discussion of identity politics in the Trump era, or the usage of an academic term to describe the types of subtle experiences that many marginalized groups experience. So given the silence that characterize experiences with microaggressions and face-to-face interactions, this increased usage of the term in the broader online social sphere, it represents a dramatic shift in increased visibility of experiences with problematic racial interactions that have been hidden or only discussed in private by the targets of microaggressions for a long time. As discussions of and challenges to microaggressions become more common in online spaces, these digital discourses have the potential to normalize knowledge of the subtle mechanisms of structural racism and increase awareness of how covert acts can perpetuate racial inequality. Increased awareness and discourse in online spaces may change how these events or microaggressions are experienced and responded to in face-to-face settings. So, right, what I'm trying to demonstrate here is the potential for online spaces to be primary sites for equity-based knowledge production and the challenging of dominant and hegemonic structures. Within the distinct confines of online counter spaces, people, and not just people of color, are more available and willing to talk about race. In online counter spaces, white people are not silent and people of color are not silenced. This shift away from silence weakens one of the more effective mechanisms of the new racism, wherein whites ignore issues of race or explain them in aracial terms. Young people of color are empowered by explicitly acknowledging and critiquing the racist ideologies that support practices like microaggressions. Online counter spaces and online racial checking have the potential to change the way race is experienced by young people of color on college campuses and beyond. So here are the references that I draw on. And that is the end of the presentation. So thank you so much for being, for having me. And I think now we are going to open things up for conversation. I'm going to take a look at the chat. I think people have been posting some questions.
Yes, thank you so much for your presentation. It's wonderful showing the online counter spaces have such great potential in redressing and changing racist ideologies, microaggressions. We do have a lot of questions. Since we don't have too many, I'm thinking maybe that we can allow the opportunity for the questioner to raise them. So V, would you like to kind of recap your two questions?
Sure. Okay, so I'll try to be brief first. Thank you for the wonderful talk. My first question is, I'm wondering, can an institution, whether it's a faith institution or a university, create a successful online counter space, or must a counter space necessarily emerge in opposition to and without the authorization of an institution that it wishes to change?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that the way that I'm defining online counter space here, it is something that is student driven, and formed without institutional support. But I don't think that that means that institutions can't, create spaces that, have some of the same goals in mind, right? That for sure, schools and institutions can create online spaces to facilitate discussions about race, or, to allow, folks, to marginalized folks, to come together. And so, yes, I definitely think that institutions can, try to do this on purpose, right? To learn from what marginalized folks are doing on their own, and do it on purpose to provide support for the people that, are in their institution.
Okay, excellent. This ties in with my next question. I'm wondering what constitutes a thriving online counter space, if you would use that word, and what norms around practices such as racial checking, particularly norms between people of color and their allies, do these thriving spaces have in common, if any?
So I'm trying to think how to how to respond to this, right? The notion of a thriving counter space. I think that what these spaces have in common for me is that, right, in face-to-face settings, right, because the most common response to racism or microaggressions is silence, right? That silence is one of the ways that racism is reproduced. That the biggest thing that these spaces have in common is that they are not silenced about race and racism, that they are challenging racism where it appears, whether that's interpersonally or through some sort of a policy. And so I think that, different counter spaces may be formed for different purposes. They may last a minute, or they may be a permanent online space. But I think that the big piece that that makes them effective, makes them productive, is that they are, actively challenging the manifestations of racism at multiple levels.
Okay. Very good. If I can just ask a little bit about the second part of my question. So in terms of, you mentioned a lot about racial checking, and I'm wondering if there are specific norms in some of these counter spaces, particularly norms related to the relationship and a practice like racial checking between people of color and allies that you've seen. Whether they have anything in common, for instance, do a lot of, do spaces, do sort of long-lasting or successful spaces, or thriving? Again, I know I'm struggling with that too. Do you tend to see, or does it help the longevity or the thrivingness of a space if allies speak up and do racial checking in certain circumstances, or are there other sort of informal rules that you see in terms of the interaction between people of color and allies in these spaces?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that what I found is that these things are driven by students of color, but right? But white allies participate, and their participation is welcomed. And right, that their participation is welcomed and encouraged. And I think that a lot of white allies, believe it is their responsibility to engage so that students of color don't have to do all the work, right? And so I don't know if that answers your question in terms of the types of norms that I'm seeing. I think, right, if you're looking for more norms, I think one of the norms I see is that in contrast to in-person discussions of racism where you call out racism, right? Robin DiAngelo's book, White Fragility, talks about how, right, the tendency for many white people to get defensive when talking about racism because they don't want to feel implicated. And, you know, folks of color know this, all right? And so that means that there's a tiptoeing around these issues, and you know, folks of color want to make sure that white people feel comfortable. That's kind of like what characterizes discussions of racism in person often. Online, there's less perceived need to be careful in that same way. And so there's less attention being paid to white fragility, more attention being paid to the ways that white supremacy culture permeates our everyday interactions and ways that are not often called out in face-to-face interactions. And so that would be one of the norms. I don't know if it necessarily fits with what you're saying about thriving, but that would be some of the norms that I see.
Thank you very much.
Fran, would you ask a question?
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Eschmann. Very interesting. I must say, this counter space is a new idea for me. I guess I'm curious to know more about those, but I guess I'll have to wait for your book. I don't want to bore everybody. But also, I'm wondering, I know there's a lot of psychology that shows that people in face-to-face relationships trust each other, develop relationships, things of that nature that are maybe more bonding than non-personal face-to-face over time. I'm wondering, you mentioned a number of cases where the people knew the student and engaged in face-to-face. Do you have any sense about whether these made it easier or harder to kind of develop personal relationships that might extend beyond the particular conversation post that led to, you know, people recognizing each other? I wonder about that generally in social media. Obviously, I'm almost 70, so this is not my bread and butter, even though I am on social media, but I wonder about that for young people, whether that reduces their strength of relationships with each other by getting to know each other primarily on social media. I don't know, do you have any thoughts on that or any thoughts from your conversations with them? It sounds like that you might say that this makes it easier for them to then strike up a conversation after they've read a post, but I'm just making that assumption from some of the comments you made.
Yeah. So to your first point, I am not familiar with any research that says that social media makes it harder for people to get to know each other. In my own experiences, right, I was a dorm parent when I was going through graduate school, and I felt like this, my students knew each other before they got to campus because they would have a Facebook group where they're already engaging throughout the summer. So that once they get there, they already know who they have common interests with. And I see that as something that builds, not takes away from relationships. Now, as it relates to responding to racism and microaggressions in particular, the patterns that we know that take place in face-to-face settings typically are the students of color are worried about challenging their white friends when they, engage in microaggressive behavior because they don't want to be labeled as being too sensitive or too militant. And they're worried about losing that friendship or being, you know, socially ostracized because of that. And so what we're seeing, right, it's a, kind of what I'm talking about here is that online, that worry is a little bit negated, that folks are less, that the power dynamics are different, that folks are less worried about the, you know, on the potential negative consequences. And they're right that instead of protecting the feelings of a microaggressor, and, you know, right, when you protect their feelings and don't let them know they did something wrong, and they don't know they did something wrong, that means they're going to do it again. So instead of doing that, they're challenging them in online spaces. And sometimes that can carry over to face-to-face spaces. And so in the example that was given here is that, right, as the student was being ostracized for making a racist comment online, a Black activist adopted her and said, I'm going to help you understand what went wrong. And over an 8-month period, saw tremendous growth in the student in the way that she understood issues about race and racism. And so there's potential for intervention. There also may be broken relationships that come from this. If you have a white student who engages in an act of racism and does not take kindly to being challenged for it, that there is potential for that to harm a relationship. But I think that the perceived increased support the students have in online spaces makes it so that they're less worried about potentially losing a relationship with someone who is unwilling to admit where their behaviors or speech has done harm to the people of color around them.
Thank you so much. That's very clear.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, Rob, I want to squeeze in here and give you some feedback before we move on to some of the questions that's in the chat room. One is, you know, in Buddhism, we talk about the construction of one's reality, you know, through the filters of our perception, our mind, our attitudes, and so on. And we really see this because people who watch Fox News and people who watch CNN, they live in complete different realities. Now, translating that to counter spaces, it seems that there's a lot of agency for Blacks and people of color to really counter and educate whites when they make certain comments and conscious or unconscious color muteness that you framed. I'm wondering if you have encountered, I'm sure there are online spaces in which there's a whole other world out there where white supremacy are being circulated, advanced, and discussed. And it just seems like there's still this, like two worlds that's kind of floating on the internet, even though both are characterized by, you know, non-regulation, free participation, all the benefits that you've listed. Mm-hmm. The agency is actually applicable for these other white spaces. So I'm wondering, so that's one side of it. Another type of, and another side of my question is, in real life, you know, speaking with Black Dharma teachers and friends, they share this fatigue that they said, fatigue in educating the white people, right? And yet in your presentation, it seems like they're very active in correcting and so do you sense this fatigue also beginning on internet spaces?
Yeah. So those are two excellent points. Before this chapter, I actually have a chapter called Unmasking Racism, where I look at, you know, online spaces where, you know, open racism is normal. And I try to ask folks of color how exposure to those types of online spaces impacts the ways that they think about and understand race. So I think that you're absolutely right that this is a double-edged sword, that on one hand, the internet, right? So right, that these characteristics, this user-generated, unmoderated spaces that are able to operate without institutional support, that can prop up, right, racist spaces, especially when you can be anonymous. You're hidden behind a username. That means that you can't lose your job for the things you're saying in this forum, and that facilitates increased expressions of overt racism. And that's real. And a lot of the kind of the resurgence of white supremacy that we've seen seems to have developed in online spaces where these are communities that started as forms of people finding out that they're not the only ones who think this way, right? And so we know that that's real. Part of the argument I make is that one of the strongest, right, one of the biggest weapons that racism has is its invisibility. It's that most people in America believe that racism is wrong and believe that racism is dead, right? Educators, activists, people who have personal experiences with racism don't believe that, and we've never believed that. But that is kind of the dominant notion of the United States, that the civil rights movement ended racism, right? And that racism reproduces itself through, right, that race neutral laws. Discrimination is illegal, but discrimination still exists. And so how is it that racism persists despite being made illegal and despite racist language not being allowed in everyday conversation in most mainstream contexts, from workplaces to schools? And so I think that that as you know, racism becomes more explicit online, it allows a lot of people to wake up and realize we still live in a world where racism exists, and the people that are behind these messages and forms are teachers and doctors and nurses and police officers. And that, right, that for folks who thought that racism was dead, it becomes evidence that it is not dead, right? And so that, right, and so there is this double-edged sword, but I think that it is not an equal push and pull. I think that resistance is going to win out, because as racism exposes itself, as invisibility is lifted, as the mechanisms of racism that used to be hidden become visible, that is going to strengthen resistance movements. It's going to increase coalition building as more and more people realize that we haven't finished the fight against racism that, you know, that was going on during the civil rights movement, and that there's still a lot of work that needs to be done today. So absolutely, I think that you're right there. And that's not something I deal with in this presentation, but it is something that I think seriously about. And then to your second point about racial battle fatigue, it is a very real thing. It is exhausting to deal with racism. And that is another one of the reasons why many folks of color don't respond to racism. They can be self-protective. I don't have, right, that people may think, I don't have the time or the energy to educate all these people around me. I'm just going to do my job. And, you know, I don't think that I can fix them. And so what is happening in online spaces is these are collective and communal responses. There is less responsibility on any one person to respond because it's a community of people that are seeing these things. And so in terms of racial battle fatigue, the people who are tired don't have to say anything. They don't have to comment, but they still see the comments that someone else who has energy to do it that day makes. And so the folks who identify as activists who actually get energy from engaging in these discussions are able to drive, right, online counter spaces and online racial checking in ways that benefit, right, the community. And so this, that, right, so again, that's part of what's distinctive about online counter spaces is that there is less responsibility and emotional cost on individuals in challenging racism in these spaces because they aren't doing it alone. All the responsibility isn't on them. They can type a comment and then go to class and come back and see that five other people commented on the same thread, right? That this is not a one-on-one battle. And so I think that, right, so yes, you can see racial battle fatigue amongst people who are doing these things online, but I think that they're not doing it online alone in the same way that they might be in person.
Great, thank you. Thank you, makes sense. Geeta, guess ties into your question about self-education. Would you like to articulate your question again?
Yes, thank you. And thank you for the great talk. This is a really interesting topic, especially for someone from my generation who purposely stay away from social media and online platforms. So I was thinking as I framed this question, particularly about young immigrants of color. So do these counter spaces serve to help make them aware of things that they know when things are said to them, they feel uncomfortable, but they're not quite sure what is being said and the racial undertones of what's been said. For example, those of us who have lived here for many years recognize dog whistles immediately when we hear them. But people who migrated or international students are not familiar with them. They just know something's off. So do they, students like that, participate as well as a way to become more aware?
Yes, absolutely. And so, I have a lot of data around the ways that students grow in their own racial consciousness and their own racial identity development based on their interactions online. That a lot of students who experienced microaggressions throughout their life, but did not have the language to label those experiences as being microaggressions, through reading blog posts, seeing how their friends talk about these things online, seeing incidents of online racial checking, they begin to, put those experiences together and realize, oh wow, I am, this idea of a strong Black woman, or this is why people touch my hair so much, right? That they're able to, come to a different type of meaning making to the experiences that they've had, right, through online engagement. So absolutely, I think that this is something that has potential to change the way that young people are able to articulate their own experiences with racism. Thank you for that question.
Thank you. We have Charles Lee mainly making a couple of comments supporting some of the things you said. I don't know if Charles Lee, you'd like to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm Charles Lee. I'm in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Sorry, my kids are in the background. And just thank you. Thank you for the presentation. And I just also thank you for, I found this through the Tricycle Meditation Month and then the webpage here. So just hearing a lot of confirmatory. I went to an undergraduate school, I think similar to MidU, very liberal, but also very politically correct. And this was in the early 2000s. So it was just the beginning of Facebook and the internet. And so a lot of these discussions happened in the letters to the editor in the campus newspaper, which is where a lot of where you could get some space without having to occupy the same physical space. But I did have a question that came up just as you made the point about having experienced microaggressions but not having realized it. Is that, do you, this is an open question to anybody, are microaggressions, do they tend to be kind of everybody knows it when they see it, or are there actual behaviors that one person may take as a microaggression and another person may legitimately not take as a microaggression based on their conditioning? I guess, a lot of the, I remember being in school and, I grew up in the Northeast. I had, there were Black students who grew up in the South who had different conditioning around race. There were Black students who were from abroad, from Europe and from Africa, who had different conditioning around race. And so I think I know the mistake of many other students was to treat us all as a monolith and not as individual people. But I don't know if in your research you've come across kind of a difference of opinion on microaggressions.
Yeah, no, I think that by definition, right, microaggressions are somewhat subjectively defined, right? That we, right, as an academic looking with a bird's eye view, I can characterize certain behaviors as being microaggressive, but in terms of the people that are there, that know that that often when someone is subjected to a microaggression, they aren't certain that it was a microaggression, and they ask the question, was that about race? Why did that officer ask me for my ID? Is it because I'm Black walking on campus, or is it just because they picked someone at random who's going into the gym, right? And by the right, sometimes people may never, you know, come to the conclusion that, oh yeah, that was racism, that was a microaggression. Other times they may, but it may be too late for them to say something about it. So absolutely, that two people can have the same experience and define them differently, with one saying that was a microaggression and another thinking, oh no, that person is just a jerk, it had nothing to do with race. But there is a typology of microaggressions, that there are different themes that microaggressions tend to take. So for example, Black people are more likely to experience microaggressions around assumptions of criminality, right? Asian folks, Latinx folks are more likely to experience microaggressions called perpetual foreigner status, where no matter how long they've been in the United States, they're assumed to be foreign. Oh, you speak English so well, right? This, I said, what are you talking about? I'm a fourth generation, right? My parents immigrated here four generations ago. Why would you be questioning my English, right? That these are, right, different types of microaggressions that different groups face, but not everyone always sees those things as being related to race in the moment.
Thank you. Does anyone have other questions? There are no questions in the chat box. Yes.
I have one.
Shuri, I'm sorry.
Yes, hi. Uh-huh, yeah. Well, first of all, I want to say it was really fascinating, and particularly as Guagu expressed this, you know, understanding or our experience of these two different worlds of reality, and that the people that are in those two different worlds just talk to themselves and have the same views, basically. And then to hear this happening as you researched in one campus, as I understand it, is that correct? One campus? Yes. To have a space in which there's actual, you know, beneficial and, you know, ongoing, organic, interesting conversations going on that can change people's opinions, especially the racist opinions, and it's very encouraging. And of course, it's young people we're talking about across. And I wonder, to what degree do you know if this is happening across campuses in general in the United States?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So here I use examples just from one college campus, but I actually expanded the study to include three other college campuses. You know, looking for you know, campuses with different characteristics and student population. So I have another private selective institution in the Northeast. I have a public school on the West Coast and a public school in the South. And so at all of these campuses, we do see these similar patterns happening in regard to responding to racism and differences between online and in-person discourse. And then I also have a survey of you know, 1,000 students around the country. You know, it's a little bit of a different type of data. Students aren't telling stories, but we do see a high rates of students engaging in online racial discourse from those survey results as well. And so, that each school is going to be unique, but I think some of these patterns tend to hold across different college campuses.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Ralph, you had a question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, doctor. Quite amazing. I'm wondering, has the colleges in your data, or is there any data with regards to online counter and a decrease in suicides and just students dropping out of school?
I don't have any data around decreases in suicides with, you know, in relation to these processes. I am, you know, what I'm trying to measure in my survey, right, I do have some mental health outcomes. So I have, you know, symptoms of depression, anxiety, stress. I don't have anything related to suicide in there. And I am, you know, I have found that exposure to racism online predicts increased symptoms of depression and anxiety. I am looking to try and see whether some of these types of resistance strategies can have a protective impact on mental health, but that's not analysis that I'm done with yet. But that is a, you know, that is a line of inquiry that I'm interested in.
Thank you. So the online in general for students, definitely, I'm 70, compared to, as you just stated, it's healthy compared to not being online for not just Black students, but just students in general, because everybody gets to say something.
Yeah. You know, I believe that is the case. I believe that, right, that we know, yes, that there are negative and harmful effects of, you know, internalizing experiences with racism. We know that racism hurts health, right? Racism has a devastating impact on health, on life expectancy, heart disease, blood pressure, right? There's a whole host of outcomes that research has identified being associated with increased perceived experiences with racism. And perceived, right, is key there, right? When we think about the subjective nature of those interactions, that it doesn't have to be something that a committee decided, yes, this is racism. If someone perceives that they're experiencing racism, it hurts their health and mental health. And so, yes, absolutely. I think challenging those things instead of feeling like you experience them all the time and can never say something, I do believe that can potentially be healthy for folks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor. Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have two questions. One from V, very interesting question from the Buddhist perspective. V, you want to articulate your question?
Thank you, Bobu. I'd be happy to. I did have a chance, of course, to ask questions already. So I also, you know, if Dasri wants to ask their question, you know, I'd welcome that first. If that's okay.
I'm sorry, is there another question that I missed? I'm terribly sorry, I've already missed Milsen's question.
I have a question, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
So my question is around, and I hope you can hear me, I'm wearing a mask, but in my profession, I'm a diversity and inclusion consultant, and in light of last year's events, as you can imagine, a lot of conversations around systemic racism, unconscious bias, and even microaggressions. What I have found, especially with the leaders on, you know, on my job, in my career, is in particular, dominant culture, white male leaders seem to be oblivious to what systemic racism is, what it means, though they are the beneficiaries of it. And it also seems as if they're oblivious to white privilege and their benefits of that. Can you help me understand what is that? I mean, is it that they truly don't understand, or is it cognitive dissonance? What is that?
Yeah, that is a great question. So I have my students complete a personal privilege profile where they look at different aspects of their identity. And they, you know, write down whether they are, you know, on the dominant side of oppression with that identity, or whether they're on the subordinate side of identity, right? And so this is, you know, so they're going down the list. Are right? What race are they? Is the society see that as, is this the dominant group, or is this an oppressed group? What is their gender? What is their sexuality? Their age? Their marital status? Their ability? And inevitably, even folks who feel like they have multiple dominance oppressed statuses are surprised when they reflect on the aspects of their identity where they are in the dominant group, mm-hmm. right? Like they say, oh, I'm a Black man, but you know, my gender is male, and that, right? And I'm a cisgendered male, and I haven't thought about how that has impacted my life. And my religion is Christianity, which is the dominant religion in America. And that is a different experience than, you know, if my religion had been Islam post 9/11 and how that's, interpreted or seen in America. And so, right, my point is, Desiree, to say that it's not just white people who have a hard time admitting the places where they have privilege. And so I think understanding that helps us understand white privilege, that everyone has a hard time admitting the areas where they're privileged. With white people in particular, it's hard to recognize white privilege because white supremacy gives white people a leg up. And if you acknowledge, right, if you acknowledge white supremacy, that is something that you can feel like questions your own accomplishments and the things you have, right? Because the notion, by definition, white privilege is saying that there are unearned benefits to being white, that there are things that you have that you did not work for. And no one, you know, in order to protect our own self-esteem, everyone wants to feel like we worked hard for what we have, right? If a white person says, hey, I studied hard for my to test high on my college entrance exam, and I don't want someone to tell me it was white privilege that got me here. They don't want to hear, you know, that the data says we could predict what your ACT score was going to be based on your parents' income, your race, and what zip code you grew up in, mm-hmm. right? I think that the reason it is difficult is that people have a vested interest in protecting their own self-esteem. And anything that can challenge their self-esteem is something that is going to naturally put them on the defensive. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what we see with white fragility and with the, you know, the inability to see white privilege, is that people want to emphasize the aspects of their identity that people want to emphasize the disadvantages or the challenges that they've overcome. And they mm-hmm. want to, it's harder for them to pay attention to the things that have, you know, the unearned benefits and privileges that they've had access to that have helped them, you know, achieve whatever they've achieved in their life. And so I think that that becomes the challenge for you and, you know, people who are doing the good work that you're doing, is how do we explain white privilege to people in ways where we can anticipate the defensiveness that will come up as we try to educate them? How can we explain that in productive ways, right? Using examples that can help folks understand what white privilege actually means, and you know, get them to move beyond defensiveness mm-hmm. on an individual level to understanding structurally and on a societal level what white privilege means in terms of racial inequality.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We have one last question by Tom Taylor. Would you please articulate your question?
Thank you. Sure. I really appreciate your presentation and the topics and input. And I just wanted to kind of highlight, my field is kind of conflict resolution, consensus building, and communications. And I really appreciated your story about the student who, in effect, called out the white student, and they spent months communicating with each other. And my guess is that was very transformative. Or another, there's a thing, restorative justice and restorative approaches, restorative relationships, nonviolent communication. How can we encourage that? And you mentioned for another white student, they just, you know, got pissed off and ended it and we're out of it. How do we have more of those kinds of meaningful restorative relationships where we come to understand, as you just talked about, privilege and microaggressions and, you know, how we can do better?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the first thing I want to say in response to that is that I think that traditionally, historically, most attention has been placed on the way that white people feel in these types of interactions. And so I don't want to make this an either or. How do we engage restorative rather than criticism or punishment for microaggressions? And so, because that centers white feelings in those interactions. But microaggressions do actual physical harm to Black people and people of color. And when harm is being done, I don't think that the way that we should frame it is, how can we stop the person who is literally killing someone else without hurting their feelings while doing it? And so I think that aggressive challenges to racism in those situations are, can be called for. I think that the suggestion that these need to be non-emotional responses is what keeps people quiet. It's what silences the folks who are the targets of this form of oppression. And so I think that it's that first of all, when we think about that, we need to think whose feelings are we worried about in these situations. And I don't think we should be designing interventions just to make the white folks who are engaging in microaggressive behavior feel comfortable. That being said, I do think there are ways to design interventions that are that seek to engage in restoration. So here at BU, we actually have groups where people can come and talk about a microaggression, and you have we have a consultant moderate a discussion between someone who did harm and someone who perceived harm, and then you have faculty members who come and they try to put this incident into context of a broader culture of white supremacy, so that we're not just critiquing and analyzing one action, which may have been unintentional, but we're trying to explain how this unintentional act furthers racial oppression, right? And so by decentering the individual that's happening and explaining how this is part of the way that racism is reproduced and experienced in society, I think it helps people to begin to recognize it, right? That making a mistake doesn't mean that, I think that no one likes to be called racist, because racism is seen as being an ugly thing, but that challenging a racist act that you did doesn't mean that you're going to carry this label as racist forever. But right, we need to acknowledge what occurred in order to to have healing. And so I hope that answers the question, is that I do think that we can create environments and programs and interventions that are geared around restoration. But I also don't think that that is the only way that this is productive, that this can be productive even when someone's feelings are hurt as being the as someone being accountable for doing harm to another human.
As a follow-up, I just want to kind of affirm that this can't be about, you've got to be nice to everybody and not upset anybody, but it's how do we create that space where we can talk about, what our feelings are, what our emotions are, and as you said, put them into perspective. But it's both a personal perspective that's real, not politically correct, but mm-hmm. honest and emotional. And in the larger context, that we're all part of a history that we may see differently and have experienced differently.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that question.
Thank you. This conversation, as many of you know, will continue. Every time we have a speaker, the following week, so for us, it would be the 23rd, next Tuesday, we have discussion groups and breakout rooms to help us process. And the last question, Tom, you raised about restorative. It's kind of, in the Chan tradition, the way we practice, the first step is actually the process of exposing. You really have to expose, embrace it, transform, and then being free of it, or you can substitute liberation with healing, So this process is ongoing. Sometimes people are at different stages. Sometimes being called out in that process of exposing is the process of healing, the first stage of it. So we will continue with this conversation next Tuesday. In the meantime, please join me to pay our gratitude to Dr. Rob Eschmann for his time, his wisdom, and sharing with us. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you everyone for coming and for these very thoughtful questions and comments. So this has been a great conversation.
Thank you.